Okay, so let's get started. So I would like to start this talk by asking simple question, like how many of you are doing microservices in day-to-day life? I'm asking those who are doing, okay? And how many of you will like to do microservices or will like to at least apply this knowledge in day-to-day life? Okay, so I'm in a perfect audience. Okay, so I would like to kick off this talk by starting problems. Problems that we encounter in day-to-day life and how microservice and monolithic applications can answer those problems. And then I would like to discuss some of the core concepts behind microservices so that we can see how to build microservices using those core concepts. And as you know, everything has its own pros and cons. So does the microservice architecture, and we will take a look on a few of the pros and cons. And finally, the part that I like the most, coding. So I will show you, or we will squeeze all the knowledge that we discuss in this talk into somewhat a feasible example. And I will show you how to deploy the services on Docker and even show you if you don't want to use, let's say, Eureka, then how to do the same thing using Kubernetes. Small info about me. I'm a consultant and architect around JVM. Also, I started writing a blog, and here are some of the slides available. Not only of this talk, but about all my talks. So a small remark, I'm not against monolithic application. It's perfectly possible to build beautiful monolithic application, at least in theory. But most of the time, the application that we encounter had the very beautiful vision. But we ended up with something like this because of greed and bad decisions down the road. So what are the common problems that we encounter in day-to-day life? So first is complexity. I mean, complexity is not this nice guy that comes to your door and say, could you please let me? When complexity comes, it bashes your door. And if you try to hide yourself under the bed, it will still find you. And you have to face it. Because we as a developer, we cannot go to the management and say, no, it's not my job. We have to face the complexity. But what happens is when a new developer comes to a monolithic project, you need to install a whole set of tools, libraries, go to Stack Overflow, Google the instructions, tweak them for his system, and so on and so forth. And at the end of the day, the task of this developer was just to add a new button in the GUI. So just imagine how insane it is to do all this work just to get maybe a 10% of the job done. On the other hand side, there are other way to build the system, which is distributed systems. And in microservices, the complexity is still there, but it is moved. It is moved to the interaction layer, or I would say the distributed systems. The second problem that we encounter are legacy components. So we have clients, we have to support the new requirements, maybe have to support new business case to get the competitive advantage. And dealing with legacy is no fun. No one wants to touch legacy, but with time we have to upgrade the code. And that's where microservices can excel, at least comparing to monolithic application. So workaround, this is the nice thing. I mean, since monolithic application require long-term commitment to tech stack, and it means that in order to upgrade the tech stack, we have to rewrite maybe some or significant part of the application. And usually it is time consuming, or maybe the business doesn't agree to do so. So what we end up is that programmers usually end up doing the workaround. So what they do is usually they end up adding those functionality which were missing in their tech stack to somehow make their development process or applications, let's say, rapid and short time to the market. Whereas in microservice application, we have the possibility to choose the proper tech stack. So we can focus on the problem rather than thinking how I have to combine those tools to get the necessary impact. I'm not saying that every microservice you should write in different programming language, but if this is the case, you can do so. In monolithic application, when I speak about monolithic, I'm speaking about multiple responsibility. So monolithic applications are built around multiple responsibility. And when a new functionality pops up, we don't know where it belongs to. Does it belong to this package? Does it belong to this module? Whereas microservices are built around SRP, single responsibility principle. So when a new functionality pops up, it is easy to figure out where we have a place, where it belongs to, or we have to create a new microservices. In monolithic application, one thing is nice that it's easy to maintain standards. We have teams, we create a document, and everyone follow those standards. But it's hard to maintain the code quality in general, because you have a developer who went to let's say, to enjoy some holidays, and when he comes back, someone else have touched his code, and maybe the new programmer was not proficient enough to know how to do that problem nice. So what I mean is that it is really hard to maintain the quality because large number of people are working on the same code base. On the other hand side, in microservice application, it's not also all roses. So we have, it's easy to maintain the quality because we have small team, and those teams, when you give the developers and say, okay, this part of the application you have to deal with, then they tend to take the responsibility, crazy enough, because none of them like to receive a wake-up call at 2 in the morning. So they are really conscious about the quality here. But on the other hand side, we have large number of teams. So each and every team is free to set the standards as per their requirements. So all in all, in microservices, it's possible to set the standards, but from real life experience, it requires some amount of work to do so. The thing which I think all of us like to do is refactoring, so throw all the code out, and since still have our application in one piece. But what happened in monolithic application is that everything is tight, so tightly glued together, that when we start refactoring, we start with something like this. But down the road, we end up with something like this. Why? Because when we are starting to refactoring, we have to touch different maybe parts or modules of the code, which even we didn't want it to touch at the beginning. And in microservices world, when you want to refactor, as long as you are not going to break your SLA, service level agreement, you are free to refactor. So these are the few problems which I wanted to highlight between monolithic and microservice architecture. There are much more, but these are those which I hope in each and every day of the developer make difference. So what are microservices? Well, it is a way of creating application that consists of small components, and each and every component talk to each other via language agnostic API. The word micro here is quite significant, because I remember when I was a small kid and I was going to a school, then I learned the word micro from my physics teacher, and he said micro is 10 to the power minus 6. It is still not changed. I can go and Google it around, and it's still the same. But in computer science, the word micro means something different. Micro means something small, and something small for me can be big for you. So some people tend to believe that microservices mean that you should have maybe 100 lines of code, maybe X number lines of code, or maybe X amount of methods. So what I want to emphasize here is the word micro means in terms of responsibility. Don't think in terms of numbers of lines of code here, or in numbers of lines of method. The micro here just means responsibility of each and every component. Each and every component should be focused for one particular reason. So what are the core concepts that we can use to start coding those microservices? So first is service registry. How many of you have heard about service registry? Okay, so for all of you, let me describe what service registry means. So let's say there are two services, service A and service B, and service A want to communicate with service B. And this communication is vanilla, so there is no load balancer, no proxy. So what happens in a normal scenario is service A can, all it needs is the IP address and probably the port to communicate with service B, and that's it. But in microservices, when this assumption is no longer valid. Why? Because one of the key strengths of microservices is scalability on demand. So we can scale as and as per our need and traffic. So it means we can have 10 instances of service B up and running. And when now service A want to communicate with service B, with which instance it should talk, the first one, the last one, or the middle one. So in order to solve this problem, we have something called service registry. So service registry is a place where you go and ask, do you know the service, do you know the address of service B? And it say, yeah, this is the address of service B. And you ask this question, how many instances of service B are up and running? And it can say you, okay, 3 instances are up and running. So like always, in the world, we have a lot of choices to do, starting from the food to restaurant to beer, and the same goes with service registry. So which one of them you should use? You should use Zookeeper, Eureka, or Console. So let's say if you are developing an application in your private data center, so things like network-based partitioning and zone-based partitionings are very, very unlikely to happen because you have your own data centers, you can use Zookeeper because it's consistent and available. Consistent and partitioned. Eureka, on the other hand side, when you want to target a cloud platform where there is nothing is reliable. So in cloud, for instance, when you are deploying a services, you don't know the next time when you are going to run your service, will it be running on the same port? Because the cloud provider is free to use whatever port is available, and the same goes with the IP. And in cloud, those things like zone-based partitioning, network-based partitioning are more likely to happen. So if you are deploying deploying your application in an environment where those things are likely to happen, you have to choose availability over consistency. And console is also AP, it's also available and partitioned. But for the sake of this talk, I'm going to concentrate on Eureka. So Eureka is an open source service registry developed by Netflix. It consists of 2 parts, server and client. I can show you very fast how the communication between server and client looks like. So let's say we have a client, and client want to register with the server. So first he does, he sends a heartbeat. So when we deploy a application, and I will show you right now in the code how it looks like. But what it does is a client have to send a registration. So first heartbeat, it does it usually after 30 seconds. And after that, he have to renew the heartbeat. So he have to let know the service the server that I am alive. And he does so by pinging or sending periodic ping to the server. So usually every heartbeat per 30 seconds. And what happens if the client doesn't send the heartbeat? So server waits around 3 heartbeat miss, so 90 seconds, and if he still doesn't receive, he assumes the client is dead. But once the client is healthy and he is periodically sending the heartbeats, the next step the client does, he has to fetch the information. So by fetching information, it means he fetched the list of microservices and cached them locally. And since we are caching locally, the cache can expire because things on the server can change. So the client then does a periodically update. So an update of registry means he just asks the difference between the last fetch cycle and the current fetch cycle. So the amount of traffic or this information is really small. And finally, when the client wants to disconnect, he sends the shutdown request, which is a cancel request on shutdown, and the server removes instance from the registry. So this is how the Eureka works. The second question, or the second core concept when we are developing microservices, is about load balancing. So as I said that in microservice world, we can have 10 instances running. So shall I speak with the first instance, shall I speak with the fifth one or the last one? And in order to solve this problem, we need load balancer. And precisely, I'm going to speak about Ribbon. So Ribbon is a client-side load balancer. It have built-in tendency for resilience, so which means that it can dynamically find out the liveliness of the servers and skip the servers that are no longer alive. And even it can further filter the servers based on the circuit breaker pattern, which I'm going to show you. But apart from this, it also has some nice feature like zone affinity. And zone affinity means that when you are making a request, the load balancer will only return the server in the same zone. And why it is important for all of you? Well, you can do two of the nice things. First, you can reduce the cost of the zone cross-zone trafficking. And second, you can make much better user experience. So for example, the clients which are connected from America and from East Zone, they will be served by the East Zone server rather than making a request to the West Zone and have some latency. And how it works, it uses rule-based load balancing. By default, it supports round robin, but you can extend those rules and implement weighted or even random load balancing. The third concept that I'm going to speak is about edge service here. So I think right now all of you agree that it's not a very clever idea to expose directly the address of your microservice for communication, because this part, this information about IP and port is dynamic, because if you are deploying on the cloud, you cannot rely on the truth. But let's imagine a scenario that you are developing a microservice based system, and tomorrow your boss comes and say, okay, we are going to charge from today onwards for every API call, or we are going to make a premium API and a non-premium API. So in order to handle those type of scenario which involve all the microservices, we need something called edge service. And fortunately, Netflix have provided us Zool. So what Zool consists of? It consists of three stages or three phases, pre, routing, and post. So when a request comes, it can go through any three of this cycle or all three of this cycle. And if anything goes wrong with the request, there is an error stage or error phase. But you can ask me one simple question that, okay, that's fine, but we can do all those things writing some servlet. Like we can write a servlet and we can have some pre-stage, pre-filter, and post-action maybe. But Zool, in order to understand how the request through the Zool goes, Let me demonstrate you how Zool handles the request. So an HTTP request comes and it goes to the pre-stage. And in pre-stage, you can do things like authentication and authorization. You can have n numbers of pre-filter. Once the request is pre-validated, so based on your business scenario, the request goes to the routing stage, where it tries to find out to where he should redirect the request. When the request is redirected, it is back. It goes to the post stage. And in post stage, you can do actions like add some default HTTP header in your request, or you can add some information for metrics like Grafana. You want to expose the health of the system. And finally, the response is handover to the client. So this is how the request flows through Zool. And what are some of the features of Zool? Well, first of them is load shedding, which means you can allocate capacity for each type of request. And once the capacity goes above, Zool can automatically start dropping the request. Authentication and security goes well, so Zool knows how to take care of tokens and pass them to microservices. Static response handling. So sometimes you have a need that when you are building a microservices, you don't want to redirect the request to the cluster of microservices. You want to return the request, you want to handle the request and return the response directly. And Zool can do this really nicely because it have built-in some responses directly at the edge services. And he knows that when you enable this feature, he will not forward it to, let's say, internal cluster. Surgical debug filter, this is something which I like personally a lot. So let's say when you want to debug your production and you don't have possibility to replicate your production environment in staging, maybe because you are encrypting the data, you have some credit cards which you want to encrypt and you just have to, or maybe obfuscate that data. For some reasons, you cannot replicate your production in your staging, and most of the time it is the scenario. So what you can do, you can use the surgical debugging filter. And what it means, you can write a filter which extend this class, and then all the requests coming from, let's say, particular client, you can start to handle them. So let me give you a concrete example. Let's say one client who is trying to connect with our system, he have problem in accessing the system. So what we can do is we can extend the surgical debugging filter, and when the request is coming from that client, we can take a look, a peek into this, what is going on. Those filters are written in Groovy, so you don't have to recompile the things start debugging your production environment. And last is stress testing. So let's say when you build a microservice build and you throw it to the Jenkins and Jenkins show the green pipeline, it's not only enough because you want to maybe assess the quality of the build. So what you can do in Zool, you can tell to Zool that slowly and gradually increase the traffic, which it means that, let's say you can put your build and you can say first to Zool that increase 5% of the traffic, then 10%, then 20%. And you can start monitoring how the build is behaving with increase in traffic. And once, let's say after 75%, you notice that the performance is significantly down, you can tell to the team and say, okay, the build is really nice, but it has some really performance issues. And you can do this with Zool easily. So you can configure the Zool to slowly and gradually expose the traffic. The last concept that I'm going to speak here is about failure management. So in distributed world, there is lots and lots and lots of source of failures. So basically, if you don't want to go to your boss and say, it's not my fault that the third party API to which I'm connecting is down, you should use Hystrix. It have built-in support how to manage the failures and even cascading failures. So it take cares of fail fast approach, and I'm going to show you this in a while. And the last concept here I forgot about is distributing tracing. So what happens is in Google they found out that back, I think, in 2008 or 2009, what they did is, in Google, they conducted an experiment. So what they did is they made their search slower, deliberately, and they exposed the number of users, to interact with google.com. And what they notice is that when they increase the time from 100 milliseconds to 400 milliseconds, the total number of searches decreased from 0.2 to 0.6. So speed really matters in distributed systems. So even we are speaking here about milliseconds, but even that, as you can see, the time is like 400 milliseconds or 300 millisecond increase is maybe not big for the human eye, but when we are browsing the web, it really makes a huge difference for us. So what we can do, and what they concluded from this experiment, they concluded that as the system starts to behave slower, the number of clients interacting with the systems tend to fall down. So what they come up is, they come up with a paper, DAPR it was called, and the motivation was that we have large-scale distributed system because, as you know, Google is large-scale distributed system consisting of many parts. And they wanted to collect, in this paper, they wanted to describe some way that they can collect maybe data about the system. But when I speak about large-scale distributed system, in reality what it consists is, it consists of collection of software or modules, and they can be developed by the different team or maybe by the same team, and obviously in the same or different programming languages. And they can span many thousands of machines, and which means at the end of the day, we want to understand the system behavior. So a system can be this much complex, and mostly when we are doing microservices, we don't have 1, 2, 3 microservices. We have large number of microservices. What was the traditional approach of doing or understanding this system? Well, we can do some logging, like log dot debug or dot info. I'm entering in this method and leaving this method. I mean, we all know how to log the some parameter, some HTTP request. But what is wrong when a system involves dozens of engineering teams and subsystems, then even and something goes wrong on the production, then you go to the cleverest guy in the team and you ask what's wrong, and he can maybe guess right or maybe he can guess wrong. Most of the time, even the best and most experienced engineers, they just guess, and they can guess wrong about why we are suffering with performance, because there are a large number of sources where the things can go wrong. And what the other approach that people tend to take is they say, okay, all the members in the team, they can be logging information in particular format and using some standards and using these services. But a tracing infrastructure which depends only on the team member is too fragile, because one team might forget to do things right. So what was the solution? So the solution was that the Google came up with a paper called Dapper, in which they describe how to trace the distributed systems and introduce a tracing infrastructure which will be as transparent as possible, so which doesn't cost teams to write some special logging statements and I don't know, assume some special logging format. They come up with the paper, and like Twitter implemented the paper. So they implemented this paper using Zipkin, which is an open source distributed tracing system, and it's based on Dapper. So I think now I would like to show you a very fast pros and cons of the microservices, and then we can go about the demo part or the coding part. So the pros about microservices is that it is built on component. We have component-based approach instead of modules-based approach. We have richer tech stack, so we are not only dependent on one particular technology or set of programming languages. Scalability is something that comes quite good with microservices, but you have to obviously make sure that you are not storing some state in particular microservice. So the state should belong to a database or to a persistent cache, so that once a microservice is down and when you reboot it, you can be back to the state where you left. And resilience is quite good. So when one microservice is gone down, then it is not going to blow your full infrastructure. The cons are that we are in a distributed domain. We have hundreds of parts to now care about. We need arsenal of tools for infrastructure point of view. Testing a monolithic application is quite easier comparing to microservices application. We need different way to test it. And last is transaction. So we have to think about ACID versus eventual consistency. So I'm going to show you a demo now, how we can build microservices using Netflix OSS. Many people ask me this question, like, why we need Spring Cloud, or why we need, can't we do it using Spring Framework? So I think Phil Webb, he really, in his tweet, he nailed it. So you can do all those things, which I'm going to show you by manually configuring the task. Go to the, GitHub, download the tools and configure them. Or you can just, go and eat those cupcakes like Spring Cloud and save your life and go home early and party. Okay, so the demo application is going to be built about catalog service. So we will build a catalog service which need to communicate with three other services, product, price, and comment. And we will take a look on how to design such a such a system. Okay, so I think it's time to move to IntelliJ. Okay, so wow, the display is here really. Okay, we will manage. Enter presentation. Okay. I don't know, presentation mode is much better or without presentation mode? Do you guys see this more better or in presentation mode? This? Okay. Where I am? Okay. So first thing that we can go is I'm going to build this project using Gradle, and how you can start your own project or Gradle, you can go here on this URL. Remember this, it's start.spring.io, and you can go here and ask for Hystrix, for example, Hystrix dashboard, Eureka, discovery and server, and what other tools you need, like Zool, stuff like this. You can say generate project and you download the build file and you have. So I'm not going to show you how to create a build.gradle, because you can go on this URL and add the dependencies and download the project. Once you have the project, you import it in IntelliJ, you can start real coding. So the first thing which I spoke about, the core concept, was service registry, the single place of truth. How you can build one for yourself, you only have to annotate your class with @enable Eureka server, and that's it. Once you have this, your service registry is up and running. Once you have your service registry up and running, I mean the server part, you need a client to connect. So let's say we want to build a product service. But let's say go to application. Once you have your server up and running, you need your microservice to be registered with this server. Remember this client part, yeah, the client and the server part. So here, what we have is, all we need to do is we have to use this annotation, @enable discovery client, and what it's going to do is, when you will run this application, it is going to register it to the Eureka. You can obviously configure the defaults by going to application.properties and configure, override the necessary defaults. But at this point of time, you have the server and a client up and running, and then you can start implementing your business case. So for instance, I want to generate some price from price services. Here is maybe not the nicest way to do it, but I just wanted to show you that what we have to do is, we have to just create a simple Spring REST controller, which I hope every one of you know how to do it. And then you can just implement your method here, simply. And that's it. You don't need anything more fancy here. So this is a scenario in which you are calling a service and you are expecting it to be registered with Eureka server. And you can implement your methods using whatever business logic you have here. In the same way, we can create the product service, product service. So let me go, where is product service? So as you can see, I need another microservice which have to interact, or I have to, simulate generating of product. I annotate this class using @enable discovery client, which means I will register this service with Eureka, and then I can go and implement my business logic here. So I can go here, and as you can see in product service, I have a simple REST controller. Here I have @SLF4J, which is annotation to inject logger. Why? Because I don't like to write public static, logger, blah, blah, blah. I don't want to vomit more code here because there is less space, but you don't have to do it. It have nothing to do with microservices. It have to do just with the logger. So here you define a REST controller, here you define the request mapping, and here you can use constructor-based injection. I always say use constructor-based dependency injection, because it makes unit testing much more easier. And here I have some logic, which means as you see, what I do here is I just simulate generating some product, and believe me or not, the class product is really, really, really simple. It's a simple plain POJO. There is nothing inside. And this at immutable does all the things like getters, creating all my getters and toString, all those methods. So, but let's draw our attention now to an application like catalog. So for instance, a catalog service here, what it needs is it needs to interact not only with the service registry. So it not only have to register with service registry Eureka, but it also will be calling two other services, so which means product and price, because a catalog consists of product and price. So maybe those services will be up and running, or maybe they will not be up and running. And in order to handle such scenario, we have to handle the errors. And that's why I annotate this class using at enable hystrix. And what I have here is, and then I can go and start writing my own service logic, so which means catalog service. So when I fetch a catalog, I have an endpoint slash catalog, and when I fetch a catalog, what I do is I fetch the product, then I fetch the comments, and then I fetch the price, and then I return, I create a new catalog. And new catalog just means it's a POJO where I am going to set some ID and some product, and that's it. But let's take a look here. When I'm fetching a product, I'm using something called product builder. So how the fetching of the product looks like? So when I'm, as you can see in this class, what we have here, we have a product builder which have a REST template. And do you notice this annotation at load balanced? So what this annotation does is it injects this client side load balancer, so ribbon in our case. So when I want to inject a client-side load balancer or load balancer to my normal REST template, which I'm using in Spring, all I have to do is annotate at load balanced, and Spring is automatically going to inject it. Or I have created a bean here, as you can see in here, you can see I have at load balanced at bean. And that's it is going to do. So here I have the REST template, I have tracer because I want to log something, but you don't have to if you don't want. And as you see, when I'm fetching a product, what I'm doing here is I'm saying to REST template that get for object, get something using this URL and using some ID which I'm going to pass. But as you notice that this code is annotated with at hystrix command. So what is going to happen is when I'm going to execute this method, and if something goes wrong, then I'm going to say that, hey, use this fallback method here. So in this case, I'm returning some demo product. What is important is that when in fallback method, avoid using some call to external system or issuing new URL request, because you don't want to end up in fallback calling a URL to a service which also may or may not be up and running. So you can return some sensible defaults here. And the same thing I'm doing when I'm fetching the price and when I'm fetching the comments. So I'm returning an empty list of comments here. And how all those URLs are going to be resolved here? This is where the Zool comes into action. So I can go and create Zool. All I need is I need to enable the Zool proxy. This you don't need, to be very honest, because I was just playing with async stuff. And then you can go in application.properties for Zool, and you can do the mapping here for the Zool. So what you can do is inside the Zool, you can create a routing here, and you can specify how you want to map your services. And that's how those URLs, which I show HTTP slash catalog service, they are going to be resolved. So let me show you the demo up and running. Believe me, it works. Okay, so this is here. Okay, so now my screen is mirrored. Okay, so I have this, this is running on Amazon, but I can also run it locally, this process here, if you believe so, and I think I'm running it here with the Eureka server. So as you can see, when the, or maybe you don't see much, but when you see, I have here Eureka up and running, and if I start, let's say, a product service, I think Control R. Okay, so do you guys see here, this service is up and running, and here you can see the response status is 200, and if you see in Eureka here, the service will be registered. You can also query the services using, wait, am I connected here? Okay. I have my internet up and running, okay. So here I have deployed the same demo on Amazon. Okay, so here I'm asking the Eureka to give me all the information, what it have, and you can see it have a lot of information about the services which are registered here. But if you don't want to read all those things, what Eureka or Spring Cloud provide is here a nice interface where you can see all your services which are currently registered with Eureka. So you can see their availability zone, their status, and so on. And now if I make a request to a catalog service, so for example, catalog, and maybe we don't want this. So as you see, when I'm, or maybe I will make it more readable. Okay, so as you see, when I request for a catalog, what I get? I get a product which which have a price, which have some amount here, which have some array of comments or list of comments, and it has some description. But what if I want to take my comment service down? So I can, for instance, kill one of my comment service here. Okay, because I have to be in CD home, Ubuntu. Okay, so I'm stopping the comment service, and if I will now go back to Eureka, so my interface here, you see the comment service is no longer visible, yeah? What do you think at this time going to happen? Does my full application is going to blow up, or it is still going to work somehow? Okay, you guys have a lot of trust. Okay, so, pardon? Yeah, exactly. If I will run here, as you see, I'm getting a fallback response. But there is something nice also here. As you see, I have here, I'm using Hystrix here. So not only I'm getting fallback response, but right now you see my circuit is enclosed. I can make it alphabetically, so I have everything in a closed state, so means the circuit is closed. So when I execute another request here, you see nothing in reality change. I only see that one request fail here and two requests succeeded. But let me do what happens if I'm going to fire here maybe 100 requests here. So now you see all of a sudden my circuit for comment service get open, and for product and price it's still closed. And what is happening is that when I'm making requests, so I make 100 requests to comment service, comment service is dead. So history is going to say like this, okay, last few calls got made to comment service, didn't succeed it. So he's going to open the circuit, which means all the requests which are going to come, he's going to short circuit, which means he's even not going to check whether the comment service is up or down. He's just going to short circuit and return them. How long does it goes or how many requests does it have to wait to open the circuit? You can configure it in the property files. But this is where in reality the hystrix exhales. So when your service is down, it can invoke your fallback method, and also it makes sure that you are not going to end up making lots and lots of requests to a endpoint which is going to be fail. But if I'm going to here say I'm going to start once again the comment service, and if I fire the request here again, you will see that not immediately all the requests are going to succeed, because remember Hystrix is configured to let past only few number of requests. So what he is going to do, let's say I don't know, after every 20 request he is going to make sure to call 21st request to comment service and make sure whether it's up and running or not. Okay, and as you guys saw here, I'm using Docker Compose. So let me very short illustrate you two parts of the talk. So first is how to do it in... So if you want to run this in Docker, you can check out the source code on GitHub. But let me walk you slowly, but brief you enough how you can do it. So what you, if you want to Dockerize your stack and want to fire the containers, what you need here, I'm using Docker Compose. So what I'm doing here, this thing can be anything, foobar, whatever. I call it Eureka service because it's more readable. This image I create. So what I do is using my existing Spring, existing source code, I create a Docker image and I say, okay, use this image. I can pass some environment variables and I can do a port mapping so that a port inside the container 8761 is going to be mapped to my machine or in this case, Amazon Cloud. In the same way, you can create other images, and Docker Compose is going to make sure to fire, and you can use the same commands which I'm using here. But what if you don't want to use, I don't know, for some reason, you don't want to use Docker Compose here to do the things. You don't want to use Eureka to do the things. So you have another alternative. So if you want to build the microservices using Kubernetes, it's basically it's an orchestration framework for containers, but you can also do it to do your microservices. So what I have here, I have again the catalog services, and I'm using in this case not the Eureka to do a service registry, but I'm using Kubernetes to do the service registry. And how it's done is pretty simple. You create some cube dot, here I'm just calling them cube.xyml, but what you do is you create some metadata which is called again foobar whatever. You specify the target port which you want to map, you want to bind, and you can specify here some sort of replication. And what replication means is in Kubernetes you describe how many services you want at any given time be up and running. So let's say you have a price service, you want three instances of price services, and you want three of them at least to be up and running. So what happens, Kubernetes makes sure that if you run the fourth instance on the container, on the production, it will kill that. And if let's say somehow your one of the microservices got blown away, what it will do, it will reboot the new container and make sure that always in the production you will have three instances or n number of instances described in your YML file. It will make sure that these number of services are up and running. So I think that's all from the demo. And I have shown you just four things here, like core concepts, but microservices in real life in production requires much more tools. These are some of the tools that we use in or I use for my consulting clients in the real life. You can also collect some nice matrices. Here I have changed the data, but it is coming from one of the production environment. But what you can do with microservices, you can make sure that not only collecting the stats like, I don't know, threads and JVM and memory and CPU, it is nice for the DevOps, but maybe for the business people it make more sense, like how many orders were sold in last 10 minutes, because at the end of the day your boss and the business people want to see money and cash flow in the company. So what you can do is you can expose your own matrices with microservices. So here we have exposed, I think it's not visible here, but on the upper right corner there are how many orders were processed in last, I don't know, 10 minutes in our production. And you know, we are continuously drawing those graphs so that business people can take a look. Or also we can, in the lower bottom here, we can say how many products units were sold. And also these dark green arrows which you see here, they are just going and showing us a mark. So whenever we are redeploying the full infrastructure for some reason, then we are just marking on the graph that, okay, with this green arrow that something significant happened. I don't know, new versions of the API was deployed or something like this. So when you are going to production, you need a bit more developing muscle. But the end result is pretty, pretty nice. So thanks for all your attention. And if you have questions, I'm all yours. So, well, it depends what we are doing. So for instance, when we have, so for one of our clients, we have a system where we are using kind of event sourcing stuff and DDD more. So there we are using more of messaging services. So we push the message and some other microservice consumes it. But we also have other systems where we use REST API. So I think it depends more on the nature of the problem. There is no hard and soft rules.
What's your opinion on using enterprise service buses for service-rendered architecture?
Look, if you buy a Ferrari and you tell me that I want to hit it in the wall, then it's your preference. But I mean, okay, jokes apart, I think ESBs has nice idea, but enterprise service bus try to do this magic thing. So ESB have like, they come up with this nice idea that we will have a smart pipe and dump, all the smartness was baked into this magic ESB, but microservice approach use other approach. So it say that the pipe should be dumb, it should know nothing, but the endpoint should be clever. So that's the difference here. So I would say rather no, unfortunately.
Jeśli nie mamy pytań, podziękujemy na Klobi. Okay.